Power FM playing one great song after another, and this is Before They Were Busy, where I take Toowoomba business people on a trip back in time, back to their teenage years with the music they loved. I'm Stephen Anderson, and today we welcome Bruce Squelch, face of Bartercard here in Toowoomba. How are you, Bruce?
Not too bad at all, thanks, Steve.
Excellent, lovely to hear. Tell me, what year did you turn 15?
1968.
Now, was 1968 a good year at the movies, do you reckon?
To be truthful, I don't remember.
You don't remember? Well, that's really,
that was
really,
back in the 60s.
That was back in the 60s, but you were 15. Yep. And at 15, did you actually spend some time going to the movies?
Probably not a lot at the movies, no.
No? Okay, no. You didn't go in the with the canvas chairs and all of that sort of thing, because they would have still been around in 68,
there were a few.
They?
That was back in the days of the old Empire and the Stand, in the old days, yeah.
Cool. Yeah. So just so you know, what we do at the beginning of the show, so that you can get more time to plug your business at the end of the show, I give you a test, I give you a quest, I give you a challenge, right. And that challenge is to name as many movies as you can that came out in 1968.
Wow.
How's that sound? Does that sound a little bit exciting?
Do I have to answer now or later
on?
Yeah,
absolutely. Right now. But before you go, or before you do, the thing we're looking for is for you to reach up into the atmosphere and just drag a couple out, because they'll give you 30 seconds each. If that's 30 seconds added to the minute that you've got to talk about your business at the end, or I start giving hints, and those hints mean that the comes down to 10 seconds for each one that you get right. Okay, so just grab a couple, because that's a...
Would it be somewhere like the old, here we go around the mulberry bush? It was around about that era?
I don't know that movie. I was like three at the time, but... Sorry, I had to throw that in. I don't know that movie. I don't know if it was close. I do know that what we've got here are the 10 highest grossing movies that year, plus two that I like. And that's what we've got here. So Mulberry Bush wasn't on it, and yeah, Tie a Yellow Ribbon wasn't either, but there was some really quite notable movies. One I think was probably the first big budget space movie that was
not
made.
Not one of the Star Wars ones, was it?
No, that was a little bit later. It starts with a date, and like a date that's like the first year of this 21st century. And
not 2001 Space Odyssey.
It certainly was, right, and that came out in 1968. Now, which came out the next year? Barbarella.
Clockwork Orange might have been one of those around about that time.
Clockwork Orange wasn't on my list here.
There's some strange things happen in those days.
Okay, look, Barbara Streisand and Omar Sharif were in a movie, and it's one of her famous ones, and it was really quite humorous.
Movies, she was really quite humorous.
No. Okay, she was even funny. She was a funny girl.
Oh, right.
That was So that's a very very tempting 10 seconds.
I know.
I was about to start taking seconds off. Now, Dean Jones and Michelle Lee were in a movie about a Volkswagen.
Oh, Love Bug.
The Love Bug.
Yep.
Jack Lemmon and Walter Matthau.
Yeah, I remember them.
And they were a couple.
The Odd Couple.
They were the Odd Couple. Now,
that's
here's
it.
The
yeah.
question.
Yeah.
Here's the question that I want to know, that I was going to Google today and didn't, because Jack Lemmon and Walter Matthau were in Grumpy Old Men.
They were.
That came out 30 years later.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just wondering, were they the same characters? Was the Grumpy Old Men from the 90s the same characters as the Odd Couple from the 60s? And I've got a big shake of the head from the silent producer. Oh, that's right. They were Oscar and Felix in the 60s, and I have no idea who they were in the 90s. But in that movie, was it that movie? I think it was the next movie, the Grumpy Old Men 2, you saw that miracles actually happen.
Yep.
Because someone as unattractive as Walter Matthau could be dating Sophia Loren is just beyond any sense or sensibility or anything. Now, Steve McQueen and Jacqueline Bisset were in a movie that basically I think was named after the projectile that comes out the end of a gun.
Bullet.
There you go. Do you remember that movie? Bullet? And I used to love Steve McQueen. Olivia Hussey and Leonard Whiting were in the remake of a Shakespearean play that they turned into a movie about a young couple, a very young couple, who were in warring families. And she was...
Shakespeare, I failed English at school, so don't ask me about Shakespeare.
It was Romeo and Juliet.
Oh, Romeo and Juliet.
Yes.
I've heard of them. Actually, I've walked past their house.
Have you?
Yes.
When you were in...
Was it Verona?
Verona, that's right. Yep. Yes, yes. Yep, I was there last year. And the phone's ringing in the studio. Ignore it. Okay. Oliver...
Yeah.
Was a movie, and I'm supposed to have actually told you who was there. So can you tell me who starred in the movie, and I'll let you have your 10 seconds.
No, I don't know.
No idea. That was Ron Moody and Mark Lester. Mia Farrow and John Cassavetes were in a horror movie, which, you know, was pretty early for horror movies, 1968, and it was someone's baby.
Was it?
It was. It was Rosemary's Baby.
Oh, yep.
Now, Charlton Heston and Roddy McDowell were in a movie together, and I don't know how many movies they were in together, but I don't know if they were in any other movies except for sequels to this one. And Roddy McDowell actually wore an incredible amount of makeup to make himself look like our ancient cousins, like...
Oh, Ape Man is... Oh, not Ape Man.
How does Planet of the Apes sound?
I knew the ape part was in there somewhere.
Judith O'Day, Dwayne Jones were in Night of the Living Dead. Now, Dick Van Dyke and Sally Ann Howes were in a movie, and Dick Van Dyke, I don't remember what his character's name was, but she had the most sensational character name that we just wouldn't be allowed to have today, or maybe it'd be a different type of movie. Truly Scrumptious was the name of the character that Sally Ann Howes played.
Right.
And that movie had Dick Van Dyke in it, and they drove a vintage car that he fixed up and made pretty sensationally... modified it to almost James Bond type. No.
I can see the car, I think it was the
British Racing Green, I think, was the colour of it. And it had the wings that came.
It had the wings, the whole thing.
It was Chitty Chitty Bang
That's
Bang.
That's the one.
Now, John, Paul, Ringo and George were in a movie that year.
Which one? Yellow Submarine?
The Yellow Submarine was it. I think you got two or three there. Did well. I don't know, Bruce, how much do you think? I reckon we go 2.5 minutes at the end of the show. Sounds about right.
Sounds good to me.
Does that sound
good
to you?
Yeah, that's fine.
Cool. Now, when we come back, you get to choose the first of your number one hits from that year, and I am really looking forward to that. Are you ready for another hour and 3/4 of chatting to me on Power FM?
I can't see why not, yeah.
Stephen and Bruce, this is before they were busy. Power FM Heartbeat of the City, and we are going back to before they were busy. Now, I'm with Bruce Squelch, and we are in Studio 516. Bruce, where did you fit in your family? Were you eldest, middle, bottom? Where'd you fit? Or were you an only child?
I'm the eldest of two boys.
Eldest of two?
Yep.
Okay. And do you think the position in your family has had anything to do with where you've ended up today?
Not really. I think it's just nature taking its course, really, in a way.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Expand on that. Nature taking its course turned you into...
But having our own business, you're saying? Well, when we grew up, my parents and my uncle had a carrying business in Toowoomba, EC Squelch and Sons, and coordinated transport. And seeing them running their own business sort of always had my... always wanted to have my own. And I had, 14 years working in other places, and then my wife and I opened a jewellery shop, which we had for 25 years. That was Toowoomba Diamonds.
Right.
That was until 12 years ago, but... we obviously now have Bartercard Toowoomba, which we've had for the last 15 years. Actually, there was an overlap for a couple of years, yeah.
Cool. So what number one song did you choose from 1968?
Hey Jude.
Hey Jude.
By Beatles.
Okay, yeah. we've got celebrations happening in the studio right now. What we do next?
Yes.
What we do next is we listen to 20 to 30 seconds of that song, and I ask you to close your eyes, and I ask you to take yourself back to when you remember at about that time listening to this song, and we'll talk about that place when we come back.
I know.
Okay.
Good.
Let's do it.
Hey Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song and make it bad.
So tell me, look, I was singing along, silent producer was singing along, you were singing along. It is just fabulous, that song, isn't it? It's Where did song, it take yeah. you to?
Back in the days, there was a we used to go on a lot of scout camps and that sort of thing, right?
Were you a scout?
Oh, yeah.
In the khaki uniform and the shorts and the long socks?
And the long hair in those days.
You had long hair too? Did you have the rubber bands holding your socks up?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Were they just Garters. Normal rubber bands, or did you have the really big thick stuff that your mum made?
The thick ones, yep. And yeah, had all that stuff. So.
Okay.
Yeah, back in those days we used to go on a lot of organised camps, but we also had a few with a few of our mates and... that was the days when we'd have the little transistor radios because they'd just come out and it'd be a way of getting away from mum and dad for the weekend and go down the bush and camping and listening to good music or what we thought was good music at the time, which obviously it was.
Through a transistor radio, they felt like they were really producing good music, didn't they?
Well, they were a lot better than the old crystal set that we used to have.
Okay, that's a good point. I wish I could actually pick one up and listen to what... Because we were listening on AM radio at the time, weren't
that's
we?
Right.
There wasn't FM back,
no FM,
back
no.
in 1968. And, yeah, no, that's cool. Just the thought. I can feel it in my hand, a transistor radio. Cool.
Yep.
So Scouts was all boys then, and you went on these camps and you had your tranny going.
Yep.
And was it a sing-along type thing?
At night time it was. We'd sit around the campfire and, have a cup of tea or whatever else we had with us at the time.
Yep.
It wasn't always a cup of tea.
Well, so at 15 you were sneaking...
Oh, we'd take two stubbies each or something like that.
Yeah, good on you.
Yeah, we thought we were doing pretty good in those days.
Should I? Yeah. Okay. And did the scoutmaster always have to play a guitar? Because I never made the scouts. I was in Cubs, but my scoutmaster had to play the guitar. Anytime we were anywhere near a campfire?
There was always somebody there with a guitar. Mm. Always somebody had a guitar, whether it was a scoutmaster or one of the boys. Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, and actually that's where we also started off looking at, we wanted to start our own band.
Oh, right. So you're a muso too?
Well, we thought we were. Well,
so what did you play?
Back in those days, I actually used to play keyboard. I learned piano for many years.
Right.
Can't play a thing now. Wouldn't have a clue.
Of any instrument?
I can play a computer, the music on the... that way, that's about it.
That just doesn't count. That doesn't count at all. Okay.
Yeah, play the radio, that's me.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Yeah.
And... So you lost the skill of playing the piano. Is that something you miss?
Well, I learnt for so many years. I got up to grade 3 or 4 or 5, I think it was, and I did theory for quite a number of years, and I'd go to the exams, get 100%. I thought I knew it all, so I'd give it away.
Right.
That was me, muso.
Okay, is that something that followed you through your life? Did you do, you got to know as much as you needed to know, so it was time to move on?
Not really. In some things, yes. Business-wise, probably not.
Mm-hmm.
Always looking to, in business, to learn more so that you're, especially when we had the jewellery shop, because there's so much to know in the jewellery with diamonds and coloured stones and so on like that, so... In that we did our GEMO course, both my wife and I. So we got our diplomas in that in gemology. Went on then and did our evaluation course. That was back in the mid-80s.
Mm.
And always doing updates. You always got to keep on top of, regardless of what business you're in, you've got to know what you're talking about. And otherwise you just get swallowed up by all the competition.
Words of wisdom. Perfect way to segue into This is the Beatles. This is Hey Jude on Power FM.
Hey Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song. make it better. Hey Jude, don't be afraid. You were made to go out and get her. The minute you let her under your skin, then you begin to make it better.
Thank you. powerfmradio.com.au is where you can find us anywhere in this world. And this is Before They Were Busy. I'm here with Bruce Squelch. Sorry, Bruce, I just love the way your name comes out the end there. Sorry, the Squelch. Did you, when you add it to a lisp, it really is quite an interesting sensation saying it.
With a lisp.
With a lisp, yes. So, first question. Okay, you've taken on the Bartercard franchise and have had it for 15 years.
Yes.
And I reckon that must be a pretty tough gig because it's outside the box for most people and it must really tax you trying to communicate with all of these business owners across Toowoomba about it.
Right. Yeah, because we've got so many different types of business members or part of our network.
Yeah.
From one-man operations guys that, say, mow grass or clean windows up to businesses that have got half a dozen or more outlets in various shops. And there's,
I think what I was getting at is I reckon it would be as hard as selling insurance, if that sounds reasonable. Would you put it on that sort of a level?
Trying to describe or explaining where all the benefits come from, we've really got to understand your business first so that we know that it's going to fit with you or not.
Okay.
So there's no use getting involved with something if it's not going to work with your business. So the more we know about you, the more we know what we can do to help. And from there on, we've got to, we work individually with so many different types of businesses.
Okay, so pretty much sales 101 is what we're talking about here.
Pretty well, yeah. Yeah, okay. You've got to be adaptable too.
You've got to be adaptable. Okay, well, let's adapt ourselves back to 1968. Do you want to talk about 1968?
Oh, yeah.
Right. Cool. How did you get around?
In those days, I had push bike.
Right.
Yep.
Okay.
That's when I wasn't driving the old man's truck.
I was going to say, because your dad was in the business, and at 15, did your dad know you were driving his truck, or were you borrowing it?
Back in those days, they had a street stall when they used to have the old street stalls in the middle of town that people would hire to sell their wares.
Yep.
So I'd go down with dad of a morning, help him put up the street stall, throw me bike on the back of the truck, and then I'd drive from there up to high school, take the bike off and push it up into the bike rack. But this is at 15 years of age. I learned to drive when I was about 8 or 9, I think it was, in the
trucks. So were you on a farm?
No, it was in town.
So at 8 or 9 you learned to drive in town?
Up and down what used to be the old railway yards where the Victoria Street goes through now, actually.
So cool. So, there's so many questions that can come from that.
Yeah.
Was there ever any concerns with the coppers in town if they spotted you? Or would they just say, oh, no, that's young Bruce and we know he's been driving up and down the...
I don't think we ever ran across any coppers back in those days. You know, we were pretty careful. We weren't stupid about it. You know, it was...
Drove sensibly, unlike what it was like after you got your licence.
They're probably not going to expect a 15-year-old kid to be driving a 6-ton truck around town, are they?
So once you pushed your bike up to the bike racks, what'd you do with the truck?
Oh, Dad took the truck back to work.
All right.
Yeah.
So Dad was sitting in the passenger seat.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Of course. Why not? I remember being hauled over the coals. My daughter, when she was 8, we were on the beach up at Inskip Point.
Yes.
An old Land Cruiser troop carrier, I think it was. Mm-hmm. And I put my daughter in behind the... And didn't... Oh, my mother got up me. My wife got up me. My ex-wife got up me. Everybody revved it right up me. And I'm thinking, has life changed that much? I don't think I was 8. I think I was probably 10 when my dad actually bought me an old Vauxhall, because we lived on 3 acres down
there. Yes.
And there was enough room on 3 acres to totally wreck this dirty old Vauxhall. Yeah.
My brother did that to a Hillman back up when we lived up in Hume Street.
Round and
round in circles.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Clutch gone.
And same sort of thing with our kids. They wanted to learn to drive when they were young. So, like you say, up the beach, I'd go and bog the four-wheel drive. Well, if you can get it out of the bog, you can drive it. They did.
Oh, good on them.
That's, they had so much time up the beach with us in those days that that's what you do.
That's cool. Yeah. It's changed kids today with helicopter parents and all that sort of stuff. But we'll move on. Were you still at school? That would have been grade 10.
Right.
So were you still at school? Were you about to finish? How far did you go?
Grade 10 is where I did finish.
Right.
Finished in grade 10. I then worked, I had 4 years out at the bacon factory, working in the office there through a number of different roles. Left there, went to the foundry for a year, and then to Southern Cross Machinery for 10 years, or 9 years, I should say, at Southern Cross.
Have you picked up a trade somewhere along the way here?
Not in those. No. Not until I got into when we started the jewellery shop in 1980.
Yep.
And learned all about the gemology side of things. Yeah.
Okay. Which school were you at? Did you say Centenary Heights?
No. Right. Primary school was Harlaxton.
Yep.
And secondary school was Mount Lofty.
Okay.
State school.
Yeah. Okay. Sports. Did you play or follow sports?
Any particular ones? Football, cricket, all those sort of things. Squash, basketball. Wasn't much good at any of them, but I certainly gave it a go.
Gave them all a go?
Yeah.
Okay. So it was a lot more time spent exercising in 1968 by the 15-year-olds is what you're saying.
That sort of thing. And then also we used to go to the coast a fair bit, probably once a month. My parents had a house down there, and we'd have to go down and mow the grass. So we're always surfing when we went down there, all that sort of stuff. So, yeah.
Why not? Yeah. Why not? So, 15 years old. Was that about the time you had your first kiss?
Oh, I'd be 15, 16, about somewhere about
okay,
that.
So
yeah.
Tell us about that. Who was the girl? It was a girl?
Yes, it was a girl.
Sorry, there's nothing wrong with that.
What was her name?
Oh, no.
I think it was... No, it wasn't Deb.
It
no.
wasn't your lovely and beautiful wife who you've been married to for 30
years. That was very shortly after
yeah,
that.
It was? Okay.
Yeah.
So your wife and you are childhood sweethearts or teenagerhood sweethearts?
Oh, yeah, from about 16, 17 onwards, I suppose, yeah.
Oh, that's sensational. That doesn't happen. That just doesn't happen anymore, does it?
42 years and we're married now, you know. It's that, two or three life sentences, isn't it?
Oh, don't do that. You've done something pretty special there. No one. No one does that anymore.
Oh, no. We get along all right. Yeah, we're pretty good.
Cool. Okay, so you don't remember, do you remember your first kiss?
Barely?
Okay. Then tell us about, seems Deb only came along 18 months later. Was that first kiss with the woman you were going to spend your life with? How was that?
With Deb?
Yeah.
That was pretty special.
That was pretty special?
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
That was a good answer. So she was she a little hottie?
I thought so. Yeah. Still do.
And you still do. She's still a little hottie.
Yeah,
excellent.
She's all right.
That's great. So tell me, did you have a hero in 1968?
In what way, Steve?
Well, maybe a sports hero. Maybe some people have said my dad was my hero. Some people have, you know, an astronaut, maybe.
I don't...
68 was pretty much that time, wasn't it?
Yeah, I couldn't say that I had anybody as a particular hero. Used to really like the music and those sort of thing in those days, you know, like the Beatles, and I was into the Hendrix, the Who, and all that sort of thing, you know, the Cream. I liked that, you know, the rock hard music in those days, yeah.
Cool.
Still do.
Excellent. With that, we've got to run and listen to some great music, and we'll be back real soon.
Fantastic.
Stephen Anderson on Power FM. Power FM playing one great song after another with Before They Were Busy. And in the next hour, Bruce and I are going to continue our ride through 1968. And the things you get to do next hour are you get to plug your business, you get to give your 15-year-old self some sensational advice, and just generally have a great time. Are you looking forward to that?
Sounds great.
Okay, so before we actually go and do all of that sort of stuff, social media.
Yes.
So does Bartercard use social media?
Our head office does a lot more than what I do.
Right.
I'm still a little bit of a dinosaur with this social media side of things. Mm-hmm. Although I'm starting to get into it a little more these days. But our head office at Southport have their own section there, their own
social media enthusiasts.
Public relations area. Yeah. They do it very, very well.
Okay. So what do they do?
How do you mean?
To use the social media, what do they do?
There's always some sort of post going up somewhere of what's happening lately or what's coming up and that sort of thing, which I've been trying to do from our page of late.
Right.
We've had a fair bit of involvement with the International Legends of League, as an example, right?
Yep.
You know, the old footballers that are doing a lot of good out in the community.
Yeah, they are.
And I've been, you know, sharing all their sort of things. So, and why we get involved with those, just quickly, is not so much the game of football and at the end of it. That's the bonus at the end of the whole thing. But the two or three days leading up to that, some of the old legends go out into the country talking to the school kids and so on like that about anti-bullying and what social media can do for them and how it can help. It can also destroy them sometimes.
There's a lot of bullying
and,
happening
and all that sort of thing. And that's why we get involved with these guys on that sort of thing. So,
okay. Yeah. What sort of involvement?
With the footballers, you mean? Well, they give experiences of where they've been, what they're doing through social media, what's happening or has happened through bullying and depression to try and cut out a lot of the, you know, the suicides that are happening. It's too many people are being bullied one way or another and that sort of thing. So that's what these guys are all about. Yeah.
Cool. Cool. I'll see you next hour. This is Stephen Anderson with Bruce Squelch on Before They Were Busy. Stick around. Playing the soundtrack of your life, this is Power FM with Before They Were Busy, where I take Toowoomba business people on a trip back in time, back to their teenage years, with the music they loved. Stephen here, Bruce and I are about to climb back into the TARDIS and take our second ride back to 1968. I figured from 1968, the TARDIS would have to be the time machine you love the most. Were you a Doctor Who nut?
No, I saw it occasionally, but not a lot.
Everyone in our generation, from your generation through to my generation, were Doctor Who crazed.
I would think so, yeah.
Yeah, yep. Yeah. So tell me about Toowoomba in 1968.
Well, certainly it's nothing like what it is today. Back in those days, we lived up in Hume Street, up near where Northlands is now.
Yes.
On the corner of Hume and Shilcott Street, we had a few acres there where we used to actually run cattle. I had cattle there. I also had some up behind at the end of Yates and Wonga Street. We had 40 acres up there. That's all. It's all suburb now.
Yeah.
But yeah, that kept the grass down, paid the rates, and made a few bob out of that sort of thing. But yeah, so back in those days, we had cattle basically in the centre of the city.
Yeah.
I can remember back then too. That's when Channel 1045A was going, and
What is the Channel 1045A?
Channel 1045A, there was three different stations, one place, up on Mount Lofty.
Yep.
And because we're reasonably close, I used to go up to the TV station every now and then for the afternoon, or just probably a bit before 68.
Yeah.
But you'd go up there for the Channel 10 Juniors thing after school with Errol Anderson, that I don't know if you remember Errol, but our producer here may know him. He used to be I think he was on 4GR as well at the time. Okay. I know that's in the old AM days and that sort of thing. And
so it wasn't just sort of a repeater station for the main capital stations. It was actually a fair dinkum TV station.
Yeah,
had all of the shows.
It was DDQ 10 Darling Downs, I think it was, from memory.
Right.
And back in those days, yeah, probably the in the commercial stations in radio was probably 4GR. I hope I can mention that in these, because actually I had a pretty close association with that, in that my wife's father was the chief tech there.
Oh, okay.
And actually, and I can go back to when he designed and built their station up in Margaret Street. But the fact that my father had the carrying business back in those days, I used to help him on the weekends and that sort of thing as well on the Saturday mornings, and knew a lot of the other business people around town. With that business, we also used to bring up all the Forex from Brisbane, anything that arrived in Toowoomba come that way, and I knew virtually every pub in town and where all the keys were to their storerooms.
Oh,
at 15 year old.
That's sensational. Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay. That sounds cool. That sounds like a really nice place to be. Was it?
It was good in those days. They were the times when you could go downtown, want to go down shopping, you even leave the back door open. You didn't even think of closing it, let alone lock it.
Mm.
We used to have a lot of fun with all the other kids. You know, you'd make your own fun. There was no, you know, very few of us had TVs. And, you know, you're out on your push bike or whatever, outside playing, no computers or anything like that these days. Yeah, it was great fun. Had a ball.
Cool. Yeah. Thank you for that trip back in time. I'm getting visions of what Toowoomba was like back then. I can't believe you had cattle so close to what is now the centre of town.
Yeah, too right.
Stephen Anderson here with Bruce Squelch. Before they were busy on Power FM. Power FM playing one memory after another with Before They Were Busy. And I am back with Bruce Squelch. Bruce, you've chosen a second number one song from 1968.
I have. Which one did I? The Beach Boys.
Beach Boys,
yeah.
It was.
Do it again.
That's it.
Do it again.
Absolutely. So we're going to play that in a moment, but before we do, we're going to jump in that TARDIS and we're going to head back. We're going to head back to 1968.
Right.
To Mount Lofty High School.
Yes.
We're going to stand at the front gate. Bell has just rung, walking towards us as a young Bruce Squelch. What advice would you offer that young man?
Well, probably in keeping with the Beach Boys.
Right. Surf more.
Surf more, wear a hat, wear plenty of sunscreen, look after your skin.
Okay.
That's one of the big things.
This is sounding to me like someone's had a few little bits cut out of him in recent times. Is that right?
Oh, half a dozen here and there.
Half a dozen, right. Okay.
Yeah. Study well. You know, make sure that you pay attention to the teachers.
Right.
And do as they tell you.
Right. You were not the type of student who did as you were told?
Quite often not exactly. things that I liked, I did well. Things that I got bored with, who cares? I'll
Fair
admit
enough.
It.
Okay, yeah. No, that's cool. There were lots of us like that. Because at the time, school wasn't for everyone. There was stuff we could do when we left school at 15.
Yeah, we could out surfing. All sorts of things. Yeah.
But you went to a job and then to another job and then to another job, and they were there. They were there then. We didn't have to be held in school until way too long.
Finished school on Friday and started work on a Monday.
Okay. And that job, you told me what that job was.
That was at the bacon factory in the office out there at the bacon factory.
So what did a 15-year-old do in the office?
Well, I started off probably as rouseabout around the office and doing the mail and so on, like that sort of thing. From there on, I went into the livestock department and helped in the office with all the accounting side of things there, but ended up as well as that down grading sheep, weighing sheep and grading pigs. Because that's what I was doing when I came back upstairs with all the paperwork. So, yeah.
Okay. Did you enjoy it?
I loved it.
Was it on the nose? I remember during my apprenticeship, I did some work out at KR Darling Downs, and that was just so on the nose.
Monday morning, the other part of my job, I had to go down and record how many cattle skins came off the cattle from the previous day's kill. Monday morning, you'd go down to do the cattle skin numbers, and that's down near the digester that's been cooking all weekend, and that was not a nice smell.
Lovely.
That was terrible.
Lovely. So, on an average day, how many cattle skins did you count?
What did they do out there? In those days, I think there was anywhere between 80 to 120.
Okay.
It was nowhere near as big as somewhere like Beef City or Oakey or anything like that, but in those days, it wasn't a bad number for the size. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Last words, the last piece of advice you'll give that young man, because so far we've got surf more and listen to your teachers.
Yep. Don't drink too much.
Okay.
Drink in moderation is probably the right word.
Drink in moderation. Okay. And with that, we'll go and listen to the Breeze. Oh, hang on. We'll go and listen to the Beach Boys.
And we'll do it again.
And we'll do it again here on Power FM.
It's all
Power FM rocks Toowoomba with Before They Were Busy. Now, Bruce, you and I are back, and we're back for your not-so-free plug.
Okay. Right.
Why do you reckon I call it a not-so-free plug? It's because I've put you to work this afternoon, and this is how you get paid.
Right.
So you get a full 60 seconds plus, I think, a minute and a half from all of those hundreds of videos.
Movies.
See, that's showing the day we're in now.
So
the
there's another
5 seconds. And 2.5 minutes to yarn away as much as you'd like, talk to the people of Toowoomba, talk to the people down the bottom of the range, talk to the people all over this world as we're streaming, and tell them all about your business.
Well, Bartercard itself was founded in 1991 at the Gold Coast. Our head office is still at the Gold Coast.
So it's an Australian company?
We're a Queensland company, yeah.
Oh, serious? I thought it was sort of brought in. But I'll shut up and let you keep going.
No, it was started at the Gold Coast in 1991.
Mm.
We're now in 9 countries throughout the world, and growing. Yeah. They've just opened up over in France, about to open up in Israel very shortly is another one. But, you know, we're here in Australia, New Zealand, US, UK, Thailand, etc., etc. Basically, what we are, we're a business-to-business network of people where we exchange goods and services without cash. So we basically guarantee that that we can bring you new customers that you would not normally have had, help you save some cash on your everyday expenses to ultimately make more profit. We're predominantly small to medium business, business people, because if you are a retailer that's selling whatever, and everybody's always got something that's sitting in the corner there, hasn't sold, collecting dust, what do you do with it? You either throw it out if it's a perishable, or you discount it or whatever to try and move it out. With Bartercard, we're able to move that sort of product without discounting it to other businesses. You've then got a credit within the Bartercard network, so we work with you as to where do you normally spend cash.
Okay.
Because if you can use your Bartercard credit, your cash stays in the till. So really, it's all about getting business that you would not normally get, so keeping your money in the till and eventually making more profit. And this works.
Because the name itself, Bartercard,
yes,
sort of gives me the impression that, you know, you like 100 years ago, where you'd swap this for the other. You're just like a middleman.
It's the same sort of thing where I might want what you've got, but you don't want what I've got. Well, Bartercard negates all that because it's Bartercard's really a record-keeping system, so that you sell your product, you've got a credit, you don't have to come back to me, you can use anybody else in the network, right? So, it's all about the old barter system, but taking the one-on-one out of it. It makes it so much more flexible.
Okay. And you've been doing it 15 years and loving it, I'm guessing?
I've been a member of Bartercard for 20 years.
Right.
I wish I'd been there for the whole 26, but I've been there as a member for over 20 years. We've had the franchise now over 15 years. And, our office is in Campbell Street, 130 Campbell Street, just up from the Spotted Cow.
Oh, yes.
And our job here really is, by our job, I mean me and Linda and so on like that at the office, is to service our clients, is to help promote your business, help you save your cash, as I said.
Okay.
So we don't look after the transactional side of things. That's all recorded at head office on a plastic card, exactly the same sort of thing like a Visa or a MasterCard. And from that side of things, the ATO look upon us as just really another form of payment. So cash, check, credit card, barter card, same thing, GST is applicable, nothing is different. Yeah.
Cool. So if I wanted to use Bartercard here in Toowoomba, what could I buy?
Well, we've got all sorts of products and services. Well, you can advertise on PowerFM.
Oh, there you
on
go.
Bartercard.
There you go.
So,
okay.
So, we've got, like I said, we've got people that from grass mowing, window cleaning to all sorts of different
can
products.
Can I go and get
services.
A coffee?
Coffees, of course you can.
Okay.
Yeah, so,
And
normally we don't want every business in Bartercard. We only have one or two of each type of business.
Right.
Because the idea is that it gives you an edge over your competitor. Mm-hmm. So if I can come to you and use Bartercard, why would I pay cash to the bloke down the road? So you're guaranteed of getting me as a client. Yeah.
Sounds like fairly good business sense.
Yeah, okay. Exactly.
Cool. So I think you're 3.5. Was it 3.5 minutes? I think your 3.5 minutes is just about up.
Did I have another 5 seconds?
You can have I think you can have another 5 seconds. If the people out there want to get in touch with you, how would they do that?
You can email me at bruce.squelch.
How do you spell Squelch?
S-Q-U-E-L-C-H at au30.bartercard.net. Phone number 4632-4333, or drop into the office at 130 Campbell Street, as I said, just up from the Spotted Cow.
And that is Bruce from Bartercard on PowerFM. Playing the soundtrack of your life, this is Power FM with Before They Were Busy. Our time is just about up, and I want to thank you for joining us for our afternoon tribute to the incredible business people of Toowoomba. Don't forget, if you know someone who fits the bill, a brilliant business person who works way too hard, is way too busy, and just really needs a trip back in time like the one you've had today, Bruce, you can just dob them in. You can dob them in by sending me an email at stephen@outbackhypnosis.com. That is Stephen with a PH at outbackhypnosis.com to dob in a great business person to come on the show. Now, Bruce, I've got a story to tell you. In my hypnosis show, sometimes I will do something like take someone's name away so they can't remember their name. And if it's a lady...
You can do that to me.
You can do that yourself. If it's a lady, I will often replace it with some other name. And what name do you think I would normally use in my show if I'm going to replace a lady's name?
A lady's name?
Yes. I give them the name Bruce.
All right.
And I do that often. And three times I've run into someone who just hasn't taken to the name at all. And I found out each time after that that I've chosen the name of an ex that they just hate. And it started me wondering, you know, how many really bad Bruces are out there.
Monty Python.
There's another one. Yes. He's just a really bad boy. Very naughty boy, I think it was, wasn't it? But you being married for 42 years has just eradicated that concern for me at all, because there must be at least a couple of decent Bruces out there. And where's the other place? The reason I chose Bruce for my name is from Blankety Blanks. Do you remember Blankety Blanks?
I do.
And Graham Kennedy and Ugly Dave Gray used to do a skit with Cyril and Bruce.
Uh-huh.
And that's the primary reason I threw that in. And I just had to tell you all of that stuff.
But we're all good blokes.
We are all good blokes, absolutely. All Bruces are, except for those three that I've run into in my show at different times. Mate, thank you. I've had a great time this afternoon. I hope you enjoyed yourself.
I have. Yeah, it's
good.
Been good.
Excellent. So we're going to go out this afternoon with your third most favourite song from 1968, and that's Mcarthur Park.
Yep.
And we'll do that right now. And if you stick around, Jeff Black will be back after 4 for your drive home. See ya.
Fantastic.
For us, girl, it ran one step ahead as we followed in the dance. Between the parted pages and repressed in love's hot fevered iron, like a striped pair of pants. This park is melting in the dark, all the sweet green icing flowing down. Someone left the cake out in the rain. I don't think that I can take it, 'cause it took so long to bake it, and I'll never have that recipe again. Dress foaming like a wave on the ground around your knees.
like tender babies in your hands, and the old men playing checkers by the trees. MacArthur's Park is melting in the dark, all the sweeping ice has flown down. Someone left the cake out in the rain. I don't think that I can take it, 'cause it took so long to bake it, and I'll never have the recipe again. Oh no.
In the dark, all the sweet green icing flows.